Welcome to the next lecture in electric circuit analysis. In this lecture, we'll focus our discussion on circuit theorems. So let us see the introduction first. Electric circuits has led to an evaluation from simple to complex circuits. So earlier we were having very simple electric circuits, and nowadays with the growth of science and technology, we have more complex circuits which need to be solved. So to handle this complexity, engineers over the years have developed some theorems to simplify the circuit analysis. So the theorems are basically required to simplify the circuit. Such theorems include Thevenin's and Norton's theorem, superposition theorem, source transformation, maximum power transfer theorem. So these theorems are applicable only to linear circuits, and these theorems are very important to simplify a complex electric circuit problem. So we'll discuss our first topic on linearity to understand how these linearity principle is required so that we can apply these theorems to electric circuit. So the topic is, what is linearity property and how the linear circuits look like. Linearity is basically a property of an element which describes a linear relationship between the cause and the effect. So any element, whether it is a resistor, inductor or capacitor, or we can tell a power, voltage or a current, that can obey the principle of linearity, which is basically having a linear relationship between the cause and the effect. Now, what is the cause and what is the effect, that we are going to see. So this linearity principle is basically a combination of homogeneity, which is the scaling property, plus the additive property. So linearity is the combination of homogeneity plus additivity. Now first we'll focus on homogeneity. What is homogeneity of the linearity property? So if you have an input, which is otherwise known as the excitation, if you multiply that with k times, that is a constant, then whatever the output you are getting, you have to multiply it with the same k. So means, if the input is giving an output or the response, and if we multiply this k, which is a constant, to the input, then the output will again be multiplied with the same constant k. Then we can say that the element obey the principle of homogeneity. Let us take the example of Ohm's law. We know that the Ohm's law, V equal to I into R. So if we multiply a constant k to the input side, that is the voltage, so V into k, then on the output side we have the response I into R, where R is the resistance of the material. Then if we multiply this with k, then we get the same response. So the cause and the effect relationship is basically linear because it obeys the principle of homogeneity. Now we'll discuss what is the property of additivity. Additivity is the property by which the response to a sum of input is the sum of the responses to each input applied separately. So if we take an example with the help of Ohm's law, so if V1 is the voltage due to the current I1 multiplied with the resistance, and V2 is the voltage due to the current I2 multiplied with the resistance, then the net voltage V will be the sum of the two currents I1 plus I2 into R. So it means that when we apply a current I1, we are getting a voltage V1 through a resistor R. On applying a current I2, we are getting a voltage V2. If we apply a sum of the current I1 plus I2, then we'll get a voltage V, which is again can be splitted up this equation into I1R plus I2R. So I1R can be written as V1 and I2R can be written as V2. So it means that the additivity property is sum of input is the sum of the responses of each input applied separately. So this is what we apply separately, and here we apply in a combined fashion. So we get the same output when we have applied it as input individually. So the linearity property, which is the combination of homogeneity and additivity, in accordance with Ohm's law, we have shown with an example of homogeneity and additivity, which obeys good. So we can say that the voltage current relationship of a resistance is linear. Now, what is a linear circuit? If the output is linearly related to the input, so linearly related means directly proportional. So when we have the directly proportional, then we say that the circuit is linear. So apart from the principle of additivity and homogeneity, if the output is directly proportional to the input, then we can say that the circuit is a linear circuit. For example, if we take a resistor, it is a linear element because the voltage current relationship satisfies both the homogeneity as well as the additivity principle. So we can say that resistor is a linear element. A linear circuit consists of only linear elements. So whenever we are dealing with a linear circuit, we will have only linear elements, linear dependent sources and independent sources. So the elements and the sources has to be linear, then only the circuit will be linear. Now note, the power is given by the formula I square R or V square by R. This means that this is a quadratic function because the square term appears. So it is not a linear quantity. The relationship between power and a voltage is non-linear. So we can say that whether it is a voltage or a current whose relationship with power is a quadratic function and not a linear function. So power is not a linear quantity. Therefore, the theorems are not applicable to power. So whatever the theorems we are going to study, that we have discussed, the Thevenin's theorem, Norton's theorem, superposition, maximum power transfer theorem, any theorem obeys the principle of linear circuit. So circuit has to be linear. Then only we can apply the theorems. But the power, which is a quadratic function, hence the theorem will be not applicable to power. So the first theorem we are going to take is the superposition theorem. The idea of superposition basically rests on the linearity property. So if we understand the cause and the effect relationship, we understand the principle of superposition. Now, how do the superposition principle state it? It is basically states that the voltage across or the current through. So whenever we have an element, it will be current through. And whenever we have an element, the voltage will be taken across it. So the voltage across an element is a linear circuit, is the algebraic sum of the voltage across that element due to each independent source acting alone. So we have seen that if V1 and V2 are the voltage for the current I1 and I2, which is multiplied with the resistance R, and if we apply both the sources V1 and V2, we can get V, which is basically I1R plus I2R. So here, that principle of superposition is basically applied to a linear circuit, and if you apply a voltage, then the algebraic sum of the voltage through that element due to each independent sources acting alone will be equal to when applied in a combination. So these theorems analyze a linear circuit with more than one independent source. We have discussed that the source can be independent or dependent source. Now, the linear circuit, it has to be, and it can have more than one independent source, calculating the contribution of each independent source separately. So when we apply a superposition theorem, there has to be more than one independent source, and the contribution of each source will be calculated separately. Now, two things should be kept in mind for the superposition. Consider one independent source at a time while all other independent sources are turned off. It means at a particular time, there should be only one source active, whereas other sources will have to be turned off, and this has to be only the independent source, not the dependent source. Then how do we replace the sources? So if you have a voltage source, replace it with 0 volt. 0 volt means a short circuit. So whenever you have a voltage source, you replace that source with a short circuit. If you have a current source, replace it with a 0 ampere, which means you replace it with an open circuit. So only one independent source will be active, other sources will be turned off. And this turning off principle will be on the basis of whether it is a voltage source or a current source. Voltage source will be replaced with a short circuit and a current source will be replaced with an open circuit. Now the question is, if you have a dependent source, then do not remove the dependent source and keep it intact, because they are controlled by the circuit variables. So only independent source you have to remove. Dependent sources has to be kept intact while calculating the superposition theorem. So what are the steps that need to be followed for the superposition principle? Turn off all independent sources except one source. So at a time, only one source will be active, other sources will be turned off. And find the output due to that active source using any technique, whatever you can apply. So the techniques we are going to study, the Thevenin's, Norton's, or the parallel division, voltage division, any technique we can apply to determine the output. So independent sources will be only one source, and you have to determine the output with the help of any technique. Repeat step one for each of the other independent source. So we have taken one source at a time. This step will be repeated for other independent sources. Find the total contribution by adding algebraically all the contributions due to the independent sources. So the addition will be algebraic here. Note, superposition is based on linearity, so not applicable to the effect of power due to each source. So we have seen that we will not apply power in superposition, only voltage and current. If the power value is needed to calculate using the principle of superposition, the current or the voltage has to be calculated for an element and then using the superposition principle, and then we can obtain the value of the power. So let us take an example of the superposition theorem. We take a circuit with two sources. One is 6 volt voltage source and another is 3 ampere current source. This is a very simple circuit to understand the superposition theorem. So the superposition theorem states that you have to be active only one source at a time. So we split the circuit into two parts, A and B, where the first circuit is having only one source active, that is 6 volt, and other source is deactivated. So in order to deactivate the source, we have to observe whether it is a voltage source or a current source. Here we have a current source, so keep it open circuit. Now, for the other circuit, you have the voltage source which has to be deactivated. So the voltage source has to be short circuited, keeping the independent source of 3 ampere intact. So we have the two circuits, A and B, for the circuit, original circuit, and we have to apply the superposition principle. So first we take the circuit A. Here we have to find the mesh analysis and determine the current. So there is only one mesh in the circuit. If we apply the mesh analysis, we get the equation 12 I1 minus 6 equal to 0. This will give the current I1 is equal to 0.5 ampere. Once we have calculated the value of the current, we can determine the voltage V, which is across the element 4 ohms. So V1 is basically 4 I1, and I1 we have calculated 0.5 ampere, which gives it to be 2 volt. This can be also calculated in different way using the voltage division rule. So on applying the voltage division rule, the voltage V1 is equal to 4 by 4 plus 8, which is the equivalent resistance R equivalent, multiplied with the source voltage 6, it is equal to 2 volt. So voltage division rule we have already studied. Please go through the video in if you have not seen that. Then we see that the voltage 2 volt is there when a source 6 volt is active. Now considering the other part of the circuit where the 3 ampere is active and 6 volt is deactivated, we try to determine the current I3 which is flowing through the 4 ohm resistor. So using the current division rule we get 2 ampere is the current which is flowing through the resistor 4 ohms. It means the voltage across the 4 ohm resistor is the resistor multiplied with the current, which gives you 8 volt. Now two independent sources are giving 2 volt and 8 volt as the voltage across the 4 ohm resistor. It means that the total voltage V is the sum of V1 plus V2, which is determined by one individual method. So the total voltage is 10 volt. So we have seen that the principle of superposition by keeping one source active at a time and determine the response. This circuit can be solved by any other methods, and we can find that the voltage across the 4 ohm resistor, so that will be equal to 10 volt. So the principle of superposition can be validated using other techniques. Now having known the principle of superposition, our next topic would be the source transformation. Source transformation is basically the concept which is based on equivalence. Recalling that an equivalent circuit is one whose VI characteristics are identical with the original circuit. So we know the voltage and the current relationship for an original circuit. We can transform it into an equivalent circuit, and that circuit is transformed with the help of source transformation. Now, source transformation is the process of replacing a voltage source in series with a resistor or the current source in parallel with a resistor. So both the circuit and the terminals AB will have the same relationship of the voltage and the current. So we can have one circuit at a time. So either a voltage source is kept in series with a resistor or a current source in parallel with a resistor, both the circuit terminal response will be same, and this is known as the source transformation because the voltage source has been converted to the current source by changing the resistance from series to parallel. The source transformation is very important in circuit which is very complex. In those circuit, it is often required to convert one source into the another, and this is the fundamental behind the Thevenin's and the Norton's theorem. So here the two circuits have the same VI characteristic at the terminals AB. So when we see the terminals AB, we have the same characteristic of the voltage and the current, so we can transform one circuit to the other. So if the sources are turned off, the equivalent resistor at terminals of both the circuit is R. That means that the voltage will be short circuited and current will be open circuited. If we do that, the net equivalent resistance at the terminal will be equal to R. So that indicates that the VI characteristic at the terminal is equal and source transformation obeys. So the voltage Vs is equal to the current Is multiplied with the resistor. So this voltage source and this current source is related with the resistance R with the relationship Vs equal to Is into R. So that comes from the source transformation. It means the voltage source is converted to current source by changing the resistance from series to parallel. The source transformation also applies to dependent sources. So it is not only valid for the independent sources, it is valid to the dependent sources as well, provided we carefully handle the dependent variables. So whatever the dependent variables we have, if we carefully handle it, we can apply the source transformation to the dependent sources as well. So we have a voltage source, we can see that it is represented with a rectangle with a plus minus sign, so it is a dependent voltage source. having a resistor, we can convert the voltage source to a current source. Now this is a dependent source, dependent voltage source, so this is a dependent current source. The resistor in series will be converted to resistor in parallel. Otherwise, everything will remain the same. So it does not affect the remaining part of the circuit. So for a big circuit, which is very complex, a part of the circuit can be applied the source transformation. So certain points has to be kept in mind while dealing with the source transformation. The arrow of the current source, so we can see the arrow of the current source is directed towards the positive terminal of the supply voltage. So wherever we are giving the direction of the current, it should be always in the positive terminal of the voltage. And it is not possible when R equal to 0. If the resistance is not present, it is not possible for converting this voltage source to a current source, which is the case of an ideal voltage source. So if the resistance is 0, this is the case of an ideal voltage source. Similarly, if the resistance is infinite, this is source ideal current source. In such sources, we can't apply the source transformation because we have to convert the resistance from series to resistance in parallel. So these points has to be kept in mind on applying the source transformation. Let us take an example. So we have a circuit. In this circuit, we have 12 volt voltage source and 3 ampere current source. Both are independent sources. We have resistors 4 ohm, 2 ohms, 3 ohms and 8 ohms. We need to determine the voltage V0, which is across the resistor 8 ohms. Now, these can be solved using the principle of superposition. However, here we apply the source transformation. So, in order to apply the source transformation, we have to just observe the circuit carefully to understand which part of the circuit we can convert. So, initially we can see that the 4 ohms and 3 ampere current source are in parallel with each other. So we can convert that into an independent voltage source and a resistor in series. So the current source is converted to a voltage source with a resistor in series. So here the 4 ohm source will be changed to 4 ohm source from parallel to series, and the voltage V, which is the multiplication of the current into resistance, will be 12 volt. Now observe the direction of the voltage terminal, negative and positive. So it is always in the direction of the current source. So here the positive terminal is at the below, down, so the current source is flowing here. Similarly, if you observe this part of the circuit where we have 12 volt and 3 ohms, we can convert that part of the circuit into an independent current source 4 ampere, because we have 12 by 3 will be 4 ampere current source in parallel with a 3 ohms resistor. So now the circuit has become little bit simple. So here 4 ohms and 2 ohms are coming in series, so that is equal to 6 ohms. Now the 12 volt source and 6 ohm resistor can be converted into a current source in parallel with a resistor 6 ohms. So the current source will be 2 ampere, because 12 volt divided by 6 ohms will give you 2 ampere. So now the circuit looks like this, where you have a current source of 2 ampere and current source of 4 ampere, both of opposite direction, and you have a resistor 3 ohms, 8 ohms and 6 ohms. This circuit can be simplified into a simpler format, having only one source, that is 2 ampere, because 4 ampere is going up and 2 ampere is going down. So we have 2 ampere going up, and we have 3 resistors, 6 ohms, 8 ohms and 3 ohms. So these resistors will not replace, only 8 ohms we have to keep it, because we need to determine the voltage across it. So 6 ohms and 3 ohms will be coming in parallel, which is equal to 2 ohms. Now you can apply the current division rule to get the voltage, or rather the current first and then the voltage. So the current which is flowing through the 8 ohm resistor using the current division rule is 0.4 ampere, and then the voltage we can determine as the product of the current into the resistance, which gives 3.2 volt. So using the source transformation in one or two steps, the circuit becomes simple and we can get the variable, which is the voltage across the resistor. The same circuit would have been solved by superposition or any other theorems. If we know the theorems, then it will be very easy for us to solve the complex circuit analysis problems by any of the technique. But in problem, if it is mentioned that you have to solve using a definite technique, then you have to apply that technique only. In the coming lecture, we'll focus our discussion on Thevenin's theorem and Norton's theorem. Thank you for now. See you in the next lecture.